Hi there, you're watching BQ Prime, and this is The Fine Print. In a 4-1 verdict today, the Supreme Court upheld the central government's 2016 decision that had demonetized 500 and 1,000 rupee notes. There's also a minority view in which Justice B.V. Nagaratna has differed with the majority on all the issues raised in the case. Now, the Supreme Court's written order is not public as yet, but here are the few quick highlights from the oral pronouncement for those of you who have not tuned in to this news as yet. There's a particular section of the Reserve Bank of India Act that was the basis of the petitioner's challenge. Section 26(2), which says that on the recommendation of RBI's board, the central government can demonetize any series of banknotes of any denomination. The argument was that the section uses the word any, so the government could not have demonetized all 500 and 1,000 rupee notes, but only a particular series of notes, and that too on the recommendation of the RBI. The majority bench of the Supreme Court didn't agree with the petitioner's argument on this front. It said that a restrictive meaning cannot be given to this provision and that the central government can exercise the power for all series of banknotes. And just because the last two times currency was demonetized and that was done via a legislative process doesn't mean the government cannot exercise the executive power. On other issues too, the majority agreed with the government's view. It held that the period that was granted to citizens to exchange currency notes was reasonable. Just because a certain policy decision caused hardship doesn't make it unlawful, and that the 2016 decision satisfies the test of proportionality. The minority view, however, very strongly came against the demonetization exercise and the way it was carried out by the government. It held that there was no independent application of mind by the Reserve Bank of India. The entire exercise was carried out in 24 hours. The proposal emanated from the government and not the RBI, and so it violates Section 26(2). If the decision to demonetize is proposed by the government and it concerns all notes, it has to be done via a legislative process. The parliament, which is the center of democracy, cannot be let aloof in a manner of such critical importance, Justice Nagaratna said. Now, what to make of the minority and the majority verdict, I have with me senior advocate Dushyant Dave. Mr. Dave, thank you for joining us here on The Fine Print. I read out the quick highlights from the oral pronouncement today, Mr. Dave, and before we come to assess the implications of both, if any, I think that one question that everybody has been asking, that it's been 6 years since the demon decision was taken, why should anyone care about what the Supreme Court has to say today about it?
Well, first and foremost, let me tell the viewers that since we have not had access to the full judgment, we are, putting across my viewpoint based on the pronouncements that have been made in the open court today by the majority, speaking through Justice Gawai, and minority judgment of Justice Nagaratna. So I have, considered them. And having said that, let me answer your question. You see, one thing you must understand that in a democracy like ours, there is nothing which is unreviewable. Every decision of government is subject to review by judiciary. Judicial review of administrative action is the backbone, is the basic structure of the Constitution of India. And therefore, every decision, including a demonetization decision, is naturally. Now, two reasons why this assumes importance at any point of time. It's unfortunate that Supreme Court didn't want to hear it. And I hold Supreme Court responsible for not hearing it in a point of time. They deliberately delayed hearing it for all these years. Successive Chief Justices, Gogoi, Justice Bobde, and Justice Ramana, and perhaps Justice Keher at that point of time. So I think they singularly delayed it deliberately. Now, the fact of the matter is that I'm not an economist. But what I have read since that demonetization or in the aftermath of demonetization, three things are important. One, that India lost GDP to the extent of almost 1.5% or 2% of its total GDP in that year, 2016-17. Two, large-scale unemployment took place. Millions of people lost jobs on account of demonetization. Three, a very thriving economy. However, we may dislike it, the parallel economy, which really fuels trade in a big way and in fuels the small scale businesses, that they came to a permanent, you know, grinding halt. And fourth, of course, you know, the real issue was to prevent black money. Now the black money is banked with a, you know, is back with a bang in the market. You just have to go to, you know, Emporio's mall to see that every day, wherever I have gone, if I take out my credit card, I see half a dozen people around me who are taking out cash and giving lakhs of rupees to buy most expensive luxury brands. So cash has come back with a bang. I mean, as lawyers, we are offered every day. I don't take it. So that's a different matter. But we are offered by clients every day that please take money in cash. So black money, everybody tells me from business community, is black. So really speaking, it's very important for this country that was that pain really required to be suffered by us? If it was not required to be suffered, if it didn't really achieve the objective, because nobody till today knows exactly how much money was in circulation and how much money came in. But most analysts believe that almost 90 to 95% of the money in circulation came back in the banking system, and people exchanged it for legitimate notes. So really speaking, there was no black money. So it assumes significance at any point of time.
Sure. Mr. Dave, I get, you know, the economic factors can't be divorced, from the legislation, that the government set out to do. But as the Supreme Court majority view has also pointed out, weigh in here on whether you at least agree with the majority on this point, that just because a policy objective or the policy failed to achieve the set objectives that were set out doesn't necessarily make it unlawful.
Well, frankly, with greatest respect to the majority judges, whom I hold very highly, I disagree with their view completely. I don't think first and foremost their fundamental approach that in commercial matters the court does not interfere. No, as I said, in a democracy, every decision is subject to judicial review. And if a commercial decision has been taken contrary to the statute, because Reserve Bank of India Act expressly provides that the process must start with RBI. RBI is the central bank. And the RBI alone has the capacity and competence to really initiate this process. Nobody sitting in the government, in the North Block or South Block, has really any right competence to really go into it. Imagine, I mean, Federal Reserve being guided by a president in the United States of America, or Bank of England being guided by the, you know, Prime Minister or his ministry or by some bureaucrat. It's not done. You do not interfere with the functions. And that's why RBI has been given by Parliament, under a parliamentary law, an extremely important independent status. Now, that has been breached because as both majority and minority record that the suggestion came from the central government. And, you know, in today's atmosphere in this country, I mean, nobody can really trifle with the suggestion coming from Prime Minister Modi's government. Unfortunately,
RBI says
that as directed by government, we do it.
So what any untrained eye will find a little curious, Mr. Dave, is, and again, I reiterate, we don't have the benefit of the written order as yet, but it seems to be coming from the oral pronouncement that in this factual situation also, there is a difference between what the minority records versus what the majority records. In as much as the majority says there was enough consultative process that happened with the RBI, and the minority records that there's no application of mine by the RBI. How do you digest this difference, not in interpretation of law, not in, but just the factual situation?
I think the minority view is absolutely correct, because there was really no independent dialogue between the government and the RBI. See, once the proposal goes from the government, the RBI board met and merely put a stamp to it. Now, that's really not, you know, interactive dialogue. It's not discussion. It's not a debate. It's not real application of mind which is required in a serious economic issue like this. RBI is a fantastic institution. It is fiercely competent. It has great experts. It has various committees. So all these issues had to be, you know, thought of by RBI at various levels. It's not just the RBI board which takes the decision. Prior to the board, there are various committees which advise the RBI. So at every stage, it has to go through. It didn't go through. Therefore, I think the single judges, dissenting judge, Justice Nagaratna, I must, you know, compliment her. Her view is absolutely refreshing in today's times. And I compliment the way she has really looked at it. That's the right way to look. See, in administrative law, there is one principle which is very beautifully settled by Supreme Court, that if a statute provides a certain thing to be done in a particular way, it shall be done only in that way and in no other way. And if it is done in any other way, it is void. Now, if therefore statute said that the process must start from RBI and government should consider it, then you reverse that process, then it is wrong. So that's the simple answer to it.
Okay, so that's the argument on the section of the RBI Act that you seem to agree with the minority with. On other counts, Mr. Dave, the issues that were framed, one was on the test of proportionality, the other was on the hardship caused, and the third was really on whether or not the government followed due process. On all of this, the Supreme Court has agreed with how the government went about it. On the legality of these three issues, where do you sort of stand?
No, I don't, with great respect, agree to the majority view at all. I don't think on any one of the three issues the judgment is proceeding on a correct basis. I feel that the entire procedure was wrong. I feel that there was a complete disconnect between proportionality and actual requirement. And I would say that
what do you need to prove, Mr. Dave, for the argument to pass muster that the policy was not proportional the action was not proportional to the objective in that sense? So what sort of argument that didn't fly with the court here could have been made?
Government justified it essentially on two grounds. One, that there was black money, and two, there was funding to the terrorists, terrorists. Now, it must be, a minuscule basis. You are talking about 15 to 16 lakh crore, which is in circulation. And you can't therefore, say that if 1,000 or 5,000 crore rupees is misused by somebody, the whole country should be made to pay for it. You have enough agencies to target them. You have your CBI, you have your ED, you have your income tax department. So all these agencies have to work towards, plugging the loopholes there to stop terror funding. You have now international conventions on terror funding. So, and you have this new law that you are, using against every common citizen except terrorists to stop terror funding. So, there are enough provisions in laws today. Therefore, I personally feel that when an administrative decision is taken by a statutory authority, be it government or by RBI here, they had to be mindful that is it really required in the larger public interest, or that it is a small problem which we can tackle with some other existing mechanism and existing laws. Now that's where government seems to have failed. They seem to have just gone about deciding that no, we must, there is black money, there is terror funding, and therefore we must have demonetization. I think to my mind, the decision of the government to that extent was more based on, I would say, hearsay rather than substantive, data, economic data, which was available with the government or for that matter, the RBI. And that's why perhaps government did feel that if the RBI were to objectively examine it and find that no, there is no sufficient basis to give advice to government, RBI may not have done it. So government naturally jumped on the RBI and said, please tell us. So I think it's something which is, I feel that this country needs much more openness than what we are having, and economic issues, because we are now a $1 trillion economy. And we are going to be perhaps the third largest economy in a couple of years' time. Sure. Now, at a time like this, the role of RBI becomes extremely important, and less interference by the executive in the functioning of the RBI is more and more important.
Sure. Mr. Dave, you've weighed in on the interpretation and how you see the wording of Section 26(2) and how, in your opinion, the government did not follow due process, because the proposal, in your opinion, and the minority view as it has articulated, should have emanated from the RBI, and the government could have only demonetized, let's say, a series of any denomination and not the entire currency or the entire spectrum of 500 and 1,000 rupee notes. You say that that the act was not proportional, or the policy was not proportional to the objective that it intended to meet. The third sort of, let's say, concerning point that emerges from this verdict is, what does it mean for parliamentary oversight? Because the minority has stressed in so many words to say that a decision of this nature should have, you know, gone through the due legislative process. Either there should have been an ordinance if it had to be issued in a hurry, or it should have gone to the parliament and followed the process from there on. Principally speaking, does it verdict of the majority undermine that legislative process in any fashion, to your mind?
See, in a parliamentary democracy, every action of the government must be subject to review by parliament on daily, weekly, or, you know, session-wise basis. And it can't be that government just gets away, you know, by taking decision and then, you know, merely informing the parliament that we are going to take this decision. I feel that there was no great, you know, sanctity of secrecy involved in the process of demonetization. If there was black money in circulation, it was there. Even if government had said that we are going to demonetize, you know, inform the parliament and had a debate before the parliament and brought about an ordinance and then placed it before the parliament to pass an act, it would have been, you know, justified well in advance. And parliament could have debated it. Nothing, you know, ultimately in a parliamentary democracy, you don't allow executive to become so powerful where executive can take such major decisions like demonetization or, you know, 5 hours lockdown, a sudden lockdown. These are actions which should be deliberated, that's what the parliamentary democracy is about. And I agree with Justice Nagaratna that parliament's role is being undermined if government were to act on its own, as it did in demonetization case.
Okay, we will sort of course, Mr. Dave, look at the specific language in the written order, but any broad precedent for you from this particular verdict in which the Supreme Court seems to have given its approval in the way government went about this huge policy decision?
See, this is nothing to do with economics, but I am a strong believer in rule of law. And I feel that under our constitutional scheme, the role of judiciary is extraordinarily important, because the only institution which can keep check both on the parliament and the executive is the judiciary. And if the judiciary were to cede its territory in every case, saying that this is government's decision, it's a commercial decision, it's an economic decision, or it's a political decision, or it's a security, national security decision, as they are doing time and again, then I think the whole purpose of judicial review becomes meaningless.
And sure, just quick interruption here, if I can reframe my question, Mr. Dave. Tomorrow, if the Supreme Court is asked to review a commercial policy decision, will this verdict become a hurdle for, let's say, another constitutional bench down the line?
Not at all, because our judges every day refuse to follow earlier judgments given by them. And there is no, the doctrine of binding precedents has little value in today's Supreme Court. It used to be very important when I started practicing 44 years ago. But today,
I'm not sure if it's a good thing or a bad thing in the context that we're in.
It's not a good thing.
But no, I'm saying in the context we're talking about, like...
No, the judges like to skirt, you know, binding decisions. And judges always find ways to, you know, deal with matters as per their own philosophy, as per their own ideology. So I mean, this decision, these kind of views have been taken by constitution benches earlier also, that in economic policy matters we will not interfere. But I personally feel that these are I think this is a wrong approach on the part of the Supreme Court. I think Supreme Court should see that yes, it's an economic decision, it's a policy decision, it's a commercial decision. But is it in larger public interest? Is it in consonance with the constitutional scheme? Is it in consonance with the statutory provisions? If not, then we'll strike it down.
All right, Mr. Dave, on that note, many thanks for joining us here with your first quick views. And of course, we'll come back to you as we, all of us, read more from the written order of both the majority and minority. Judgment. Thank you for joining written us judgment. Here in the fine print.
Written judgment.
Written judgment, yes. And thank you so much for watching.
Thank you very, very much.